Good morning. Welcome to our service here in Glendermott today. We have a slightly different service here in Glendermott today because we haven't got a minister. Stephen actually has been asked to baptize the second child of Reverend Russell Edgar and his wife Emma in Kilfenan. So he had this planned, and it seemed like a good idea at the time. And if we talked about it in session, that the session members would take the service today. So you've got myself leading it, and then we've got various other members coming in to do bits and pieces, so that'll be announced as we go along. If you're visiting with us today, we bid you a very special welcome, and again, we're delighted to have those by means of live stream, YouTube, CD or DVD, and joining with us as well. There's food share available in the hall. Now it's in the upper hall again. This should be the last week it's in the upper hall. Hopefully we'll be back in the lower hall after all the painting has been done this week. There are no tea and coffee after church today. It's just we have a funeral directly after church. So again, just to give an opportunity for to set the halls up on that, with no tea and coffee after church. And the flowers today have been put on by Bertie and Pat McClemens, and that's in memory of Sylvia. We have no creche today either, because again, both halls are being used with chairs and painting and that, so no creche facility today. So the children are quite okay staying in. There's a box of toys here at the front, that if anybody wants to come and take anything out of it. I've been asked to announce the community drive-in at the new park and ride facility up in Drumahoe. And tonight, the 23rd July at 8 p.m., we have William Harrison from the Faith Mission, and he's speaking on Are You Searching? Hear the Answer. And the singing is by the Reverend David Macbeth. And then on Tuesday night, the 25th at 8 p.m., in Lismacarroll Hall, an evangelist John Weir from Belfast, and the singing's by Victor Hutchinson. So both at 8 p.m., one tonight and one again on Tuesday night. Talked about the painting there. We're almost finished the lower main hall, which is the biggest piece of work in it. Almost finished there now. So by Wednesday night, we hope to be able to meet at 7 p.m. to do a tidy up of the hall again, just to put things back into place that we'd pulled out for the preparation for painting. So if you're available at 7 p.m. on Wednesday night, we'd be delighted to have you along and to help us. And the other thing that needs to be done then is the upper hall, the curtains and things have to be taken down. There's not an awful lot of work there, but we have some work to do in the upper hall in preparation for painting again for us. Unfortunately, we have a death in the congregation. Sarah Rebecca Walker, known to most of us as Iris. Iris sang in her choir for over 70 years until ill health left her that she wasn't able to get out to church, but for 70 years singing in any choir is a long time. But she passed away in the Foyle Hospice on Friday. Service of thanksgiving for her life here in the church at 2:30 today. At that funeral, believe in her house, 2 p.m. And our thoughts and prayers are with our son David, daughter-in-law Diane, our grandchildren Chloe and Lucy, and our brother Robbie at this time. That is all the announcements. Our call to worship today. We're thinking about a call to worship. I just thought of a passage from the Bible that, again, is the reason why we're all meeting here today. And it's John chapter 3, verse 16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. And then when you go on to verse 17, verse 17 tells us he came into the world not to condemn the world, but that that world through him may be saved. And that's exactly why we're meeting here today. So the first hymn we have here today for you is from our IPH hymn book 165, Be Still for the Presence of the Lord. Catherine, thank you.
Thank you.
Our opening prayer will be said this day by David Chambers.
I'd just like to open the service with prayer. Let's pray together. Dear Heavenly Father, as we gather here today on this Sunday morning, we thank you for the opportunity to come together as a community of faith. For we read in the scriptures how good and pleasant it is when God's people live together in unity. We pray that you bless this service, led by the elders, and may your presence be felt in every aspect of it. For where two or three gather in your name, there you are with us. We invite your Holy Spirit to lead us, to guide us, inspire us as we worship your holy name. May we humble and open our hearts to receive your message. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, David. Our first scripture reading today is read to us by Fiona Walker.
The first reading is taken from Matthew chapter 14, reading from 13 to 21. Jesus feeds the 5,000. When Jesus heard what had happened, he withdrew by boat privately to a solitary place. Hearing of this, the crowds followed him on foot from the towns. When Jesus landed and saw a large crowd, he had compassion on them and healed their sick. As evening approached, the disciples came to him and said, "This is a remote place, and it is already getting late. Send the crowds away so that they can go to the villages and buy themselves some food." Jesus replied, "They do not need to go away. You give them something to eat. We have here only 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish, they answered. "Bring them here to me," he said. And he directed the people to sit down on the grass. Taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish and looking up to heaven, he gave thanks and broke the loaves. And he gave them to the disciples, and the disciples gave them to the people. They all ate and were all satisfied, and the disciples picked up the 12 basketfuls of broken pieces that were left over. The number of those who ate was about 5,000 men, beside women and children. Amen.
Thank you, Fiona. Do the children want to join me at the front? Well, yeah, don't be shy. Are you coming up? Come on. Maybe another sweetie in it for you. Get organized here. Oh, you're coming right up. You want to sit on my knee? That's better again. That's better again. Right. What do you think of that weather? What do you think of the weather? Is it good? Wasn't it great when you were sitting in school? And all the weather was lovely, sunny weather. And now, since you stopped school, the weather has been bad. So I think next year, we're not going to stop for the summertime at school. We'll just keep these going to school the whole way through. Would that be a good idea?
No.
Wouldn't be a great idea, wouldn't it not? No. You're all right, eh? That's good. Right. How do you pass the time in them wet days? What do you do on the wet days? Do you torture your mommy? Yeah. But you just do something to occupy yourself. You watch a bit of TV, right? You play a few games. What sort of games do you like? Well, I'll let you into a secret. Never I was wee, there was no such thing as these electronic games. No, Xbox, PlayStation. Weren't there. So we had what they called board games. And these board games were to teach you skills in life that might be useful for you, as well as entertaining you. And there used to be a game called Monopoly. Still about yet. People still play Monopoly. And it was to teach you how to buy and sell properties and collect rent of people. And whenever they had a lot of money to owe you, you laughed at them. And you thought you were a great fella if you got right round to where all the deer houses were and you were able to afford those. And you really managed your money and you always meant to keep money. Because when you run out of money, that was you out of the game. Have you ever played that? No? No. And then there used to be another game called Cluedo. And Cluedo was a different game because Cluedo taught you how to be a detective. You had to know what happened, where it happened, who it happened to, and what was used as maybe a weapon and that whole thing. So you were taught to be a detective. You tried to deduce who was to blame. But you know what my favorite game was? I'm going to show you my favorite game. You want to stand down? Just sit you down beside the other two gears. It'd be grand. Right. This one. It's your favorite game too, Catherine, now, isn't it? This one was brought into Catherine's house. And it reminds me, Snakes and Ladders. You ever play Snakes and Ladders? Right. I'm glad of that. Right. This one here, you have a big board. And it starts off at naught, and it goes up to 100. And when you get to 100, you have one. Right? But do you see anything on that board that could be a problem? Yeah, go ahead, say it.
Snakes.
Snakes are a problem, aren't they? Why is snakes a problem? Because if you land on a snake, you land on the head of a snake, you have to follow the snake right back down to there. And there's one up here near the top. It used to be up near the top, but took you right from the 90s right down into the 15 or something like that again. So again, there's a problem. But there's other things in this board as well. There's ladders. You see the ladders? And what do? If you land at the bottom of the ladder, what happens? You go up. You go up to the top of the ladder. And you miss out all this other stuff in here until you get further on up. And then you might come on a snake again. And this game has also taught Catherine, my granddaughter, how to cheat. Because she can put the little dice into the cup in a way that whenever she empties it upside down, it comes up with a 6. Or whatever number she needs to get it onto a snake. Isn't that right, Catherine? Yes, that is right. Okay, so this is a great wee board, and again, it's a great wee game for passing a bit of time, because you think you're nearly finished, and then all of a sudden something happens, and you slip back down again. But isn't that what life's all about? Sometimes things are going great for you. Starting off here, down at the very bottom, and you're quite young. But hopefully you'll get to 100. But during that time of your life, there'll be times when things is going so well that you get a ladder, and it starts going up, and you think you're doing great. But unfortunately, there'll be a disappointment somewhere down the line that'll take you back down on a snake and bring you back down the earth again. And that could happen at school, it could happen in the playground, it could happen at home, it can happen in any walk of life whatsoever. But the one thing that I want you to remember is that one person's in control of all the moves that you make in life. And who's that? God. God is in control of all of it. He is the person who will allow you to go up the ladder. And again, he's the person that allows you to experience a wee bit of disappointment at times. And that's not a bad thing either. But the important thing is that no matter whether things are going well for us or things are maybe not going so well, that we remember that God's at the center of it and that we pray to God and we thank him for when things are going well. And we also look at whenever things are a wee bit more disappointing, that we ask for his help to make things a wee bit better again for us. Will you do that for me? Yeah? So remember, it's not just whenever things are going bad that people turn to God. It's all the time, day in, day out. When things are just going nicely, or things are going very well, or maybe things aren't going so well, God needs to take the credit for all of it, and we need to make sure that he has the credit for it. Happy enough? I'm going to pray with you now just, and then you can go back down to your seats again. But I'll get you a sweetie before you go back. Is that all right? Because I'll promise you one. Okay, let's pray. Just bow your wee heads and pray. Lord, we thank you for these children. We thank you for their opportunity to come and listen to God's word. And we also know that with you in the center of all that we do, that you will be with us. You will be with us through the good times and maybe not so good times. And Lord, we have to recognize that through prayer we thank you and we ask you for your help. For we ask this in your Son's name, Jesus Christ. Amen. Okay, I'll get you now a little sweetie. Come ahead. Stand up, I'm too bold to be reaching down to you now. Here, take two. There's not too many of you here today, so take another one. Here, take two. There you go. Okay, our children's hymn today then is again from the APH. It's 514, I, the Lord of Sea and Sky. We're now going to worship God by the receiving of our tithes and offerings. Let us pray. Lord, again, we thank you for an opportunity to financially contribute to God's work within this church and also wider afield. Again, Lord, it's a privilege for us to be able to do that and help others, but also in these times of financial maybe hardships that some people are going through, we're still finding that we have enough to provide for your work within this building and within other places within the world. Lord, again, we thank you for this opportunity and other opportunities that will come along. For we thank this, that you and your Son's name, Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you, Catherine, for playing that. All you needed for that song there was a set of bagpipes. They will play along with you. That's it. Okay, we're going to have our intercessory prayers, our prayers for others now, and we'll call forward Raymond Dunlop, please.
In one of his letters from prison, the Apostle Paul wrote to the young church at Philippi, which he had helped to establish. In Philippians 4 and 6, we read, "Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God." Let us present our requests to God for others. Let us pray. Father God, Creator God, you made us all in your image. May we find you in all that we see and serve you in all that we do. Thank you that we can come together here to read your word, to sing your praises, and to offer you our prayers to you. In this prayer of intercession, we want to think of others. We want to thank you for all the people in our lives who have helped us in our journey of faith. Empower us so that we may help others, even by our own poor and inadequate discipleship. Almighty God, thank you for your love and your compassion for all who suffer in body, in mind, or spirit. We pray that your healing presence will calm their fears, ease their pain, and bring in light into the darkness of all who are sick or anxious or in despair. Bring comfort to those grieving for loved ones who have died. We especially think this morning of the Walker family as they grieve the loss of Iris. Bring peace to those who are anxious or worried or fearful about the future without a loving family member. Lord God, we pray that you will touch their lives and bless them. We pray for our own church fellowship here in Glendermott. We pray for our minister, Stephen, and his wife, Valerie. May they be renewed in all things by your Holy Spirit. May they be led as they seek to lead by your gospel and your grace. Bless all our church organizations and grant wisdom and understanding to all those who serve you in leadership, especially among our young people, in Sunday school, in GB and BB, for those who led our holiday Bible club, and for those who have served you in Romania with the Smiles Foundation. We pray for your blessing upon them to strengthen and encourage them. We pray for those in government who lead the nations of our world. May they rule wisely and justly. May those who have power use it with your wisdom. May they seek the common good and not selfish gain. We pray that you will raise up more men and women of faith to lead us, who are guided by your Holy Spirit. All-powerful God, pour out upon us the power of your love. Fill us with your peace, that we may live in harmony with all your people. We pray that all those who feel unloved or forgotten this day may know the love of Christ. We pray for all areas of conflict or persecution or hunger in this world. We pray for the people of Ukraine today. We pray for peace in that land. We pray for all those who fear for tomorrow, that your spirit of comfort would draw near to them and bless them. Father God, may we go from this service having been challenged and encouraged by what we have heard, with grateful hearts filled with your peace. May we be emboldened to obey your direction and serve you faithfully as your disciples in our day-to-day lives for your glory. And we ask all this in the name of your Son and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you, Raymond. During the singing of the next hymn, I'm going to pass this microphone over to Wills. And I was just thinking, the last time Stephen had to try and get it hooked onto somebody else, there was a lot of hair in the way and didn't allow him to get it down onto the ears very well. I don't think I'm going to have that problem this time, Wills. But Wills is going to do the sermon for us. But just before the sermon now, we're going to have our third item of praise. And again, it's "All to Jesus I Surrender." Thank you, Catherine. Well, it's a privilege for me to come along here just to give a wee bit on the work in Romania, Moldova, and Ukraine, which I'm involved in, as you know, for many years. And I'd like to take this opportunity for those who pray and who give. And they really appreciate it, and I appreciate it, all that you do for me in this work for so many years. I'd also like to thank Stephen today for giving me the opportunity to come up here. Although when he called these at my door one day, I didn't know where to take it or not, but I accepted it. It's a great opportunity to let you know what's happening in these parts of the world. So just thank you very much for your kindness and for your prayers for that work. First, I'm going to do a little slideshow there, and that you see, and then we will turn to Matthew 14 that Fiona read for me, and thank you very much for the reading. You'll see it coming up on the screen here. Mission trip to Romania, Moldova, and Ukraine. Them's the three countries that I was always involved in. And I usually always start off in Romania because flying to Bucharest. And then after traveling from Bucharest, I would travel right away up into Suceava, which is about 9.5 hours. And then I work right around. I have a more or less move from country to country then. Next slide. This is just a photo of Ukraine, and you can see there the Romania and Moldova. Next slide. This is my friend, John Lerka. I met many years ago. They've been a friend to me. He's working with children's outreach and also missions in Moldova. And this is us in the market in Moldova in the morning, buying the vegetables and all the fruit and everything else that you need. Fruit's beautiful. It's all coming in from the farms and that. And I met these people here for the first time. They're in Romania when I went into the capital of Bucharest. I had planned to go to Suceava, but with flights and the way they are and cancellations, I had to go to Bucharest. And someone gave me these people's number here, and they're a lovely family. I really found them very warm, very friendly, and very Christian. And they also said that any time I was coming or know anybody coming into Bucharest, you're more than welcome to stay. This is just us in Romania and starting off both in Bucharest and then moving up into Suceava. As I do, you know, it's around the villages and at work. Next slide. So you see here that we just move around the villages. We meet people along the road and we go to the villages. And around the north of Romania, it's just door to door. We pick villages, we go into different poor villages, and you just stop along a road or stop in the village or start at one end of the village and move. So I've only took a few slides because it's really the same thing as we travel through the village. And it's all as we give out the food. You'll see the bags, you'll see what's in them. There's rice, pasta, sugar, there's a lot. But we also, each person will receive a gospel tract. And then there are churches. It's the same. We go to churches every Sunday there. This is their start there. Just they've started there at the end of school term with the children's outreach and the children's clubs. This is in Romania, and then they do them also in Moldova. And they still have them in certain parts of Ukraine where it's safe up near the border. So it's children's outreach that they do. They start at 9:30 in the morning. To 5:30 every day. They'll run then for a week, but I'll talk more about Moldova when I come to it. Again, just going through the villages in different areas as we move across these lands. This is us down in. We went into a poor area for the first time here, and it was a great opportunity. You just drive in and you see the vans and that, and there's an old place beside it. It's more or less like Roma people. And we decided that we'd go in there, and we met all these. And before I knew, there was hundreds and hundreds of people coming, all from different places, because one tells the other, and as you can see, as they come out here. And when we're able to give them the food, and also the gospel tracts, and invite them to a church. And this is the orphanage. You remember last year, I was at the orphanage, and it was nearly completed. We were looking forward to open it, and then suddenly there was a fire on it. And so Christy phoned me that day and was telling me about the fire. But it's all sorted out, and it's back, and they just had the opening there
100 children or so there. That's only some of the people who was there that day. The rest are at school and that, and that orphanage now is open. There's another one I do in Pascan. It's going a very long time, and they're working there too. Now, this is in Moldova, and as you know, with a lot of fire engines went out to Moldova, and the work there has really gone on well. We have there worked with the fire service, the police service, and also they have worked with the community and the government. And then one day I was asked to go to a few schools, and we went to the schools, three schools, but I just took one and gave them a demonstration, as you can see here, and the children were out. Oh, they love this here for the day. Just as you travel along the road, many opportunities come up to meet people. We just stop the van, and you get out, give them a bag or a tract. And if you can, you'll hardly see it there, but in the background, there's sheep. That's a shepherd, as he looks after the sheep, and he'll look after them there right through until the winter comes. Not be his own, it'll be everybody's sheep, but that's his job. And they're grateful to get the food, and then they have plenty of time for the tract. Again, we just as show you as we go to the doors, some people are not in, we will still leave something at the door and also attract in the door. Again, this is in Moldova and the children getting ready for camps. This is the start there. It started in June, and the children there, and you will see the camps. They have about 300, 350 there every week, and they change them every week. And it will run for up to 7 weeks. They run theirs for 7 weeks. So the school stop early out there. So the children will be brought from orphanages 1 week, then from street children next week, then maybe from Ukraine the next week, from Moldova the next week, and from different areas. So that's what they do there. Now, this is only a trial. They put down the train this year. You can see it there. They have a train for the children in the camp. They have slides, they have everything. They have a swim pool and all because the weather is very good there all the time. And this is the working team, the workers who have come in to help, more or less having a wee run before the children start. This is up in the north of Moldova. My friend Natch is there on the right of the screen. I'm talking to him. He showed me around the building. That's his wife and the child. And he is involved in church planting and also children's work, outreach among children, young people not there, and he decided that they'd purchase this old building. Now, you have one man who has just recently became a Christian, are working at this building this last year, and they're building up, they put in windows, wire, and they're doing everything slowly but slowly, and they have their church in it, in one room. They're planning their church for the bottom, children's outreach, and then more or less games and that, and it'll be a new thing in this area. A lot of work to do, but it's great that we can help a little in that work in Moldova to see children and people reach for God. Again, as we just in Moldova and that, as we reach through the different areas of the villages. Again, more or less traveling just to show you how different areas and out through the villages and out near the border. This is the church here, the little church group that they started with. One day I was there, I was preaching in their service one Sunday in Moldova. As for God, his ways are perfect. Now, you will see it. Next slide. This is the packages and the boxes that we pack for Ukraine. They're going in there 3 days a week. And we set out money and help them, along with all our churches in Romania. And this goes on here. You can see them going in through the towns, through the villages, and coming to the checkpoints as the stuff moves in through Ukraine. There's the generators that I send out. We're able to send 14 generators. They cost about £900 each. We didn't send them from here. We just sent the money. And the boys in Romania buys them and takes them over during the winter time. This is a church in Ukraine as the people go in. They have different churches. Some churches run from the day the war started. They have prayer meetings for 2 hours in the morning. Other churches have gospel services for 2 hours in the evening. And this is the... I'm going on. Now in Ukraine, they have little places set up, safe places, and they bring the children here just to play with different toys and that, and then to remember memory verses and that. This is also in all these photos now at the end are Ukraine. This is a place that I visit down in about 580 kilometers down in. It's great to go down in there and see them and how they work. All these children that you see here, there's hundreds and hundreds of them. I went around to see them, but I just took a couple of photos that you see. Every one is an orphan. They've lost their mother and father. And you know, I was sad when it brings tears to your eyes when you stand there among them. You can feel the stillness, the sadness in their faith. And some of the children are waiting for mommy and daddy to come. But you know, mommy and daddy will never come back. They've lost their parents. This family here's house was hit with a rocket and completely have lost all. They were out at the church service or something that day, and they lost everything. And it's so sad. And when we're unloading the vans and that, you'll see some of the photos here. If you just keep them going here, you'll see them. That as we take the stuff in, it's all the women. There are no men. The men and the boys are down in the front line, and they are doing their best or whatever, and they work there in the army because they're called forward as service to stand for their country. This is more in the orphanages and also in Ukraine where their parents. A lot of the girls were telling us, and the women who are married have never heard of their husbands from the day the war started because they can't use their phones and that because they can be tracked. So they never heard or nothing. And some sadly says they don't know if they'll ever meet again. So sad when you hear their stories, when they sit down to tell you, and you know, you feel so helpless, although you brought a couple of van loads of stuff, and they always ask you when you come back. I was in Romania on the Monday, and Cornell received a word through that night. Please come and help our village in Ukraine. Our town, our supermarkets, our little shops have run out of food completely because, you see, all the roads are blocked coming in on the east side and the west. They cannot come in. There's only one entrance into Romania, some through Poland, but the main entrance is one road, and that is up through Romania. And as the lorries are lined to Romania, you think if you gone in there with lorries into Romania, you'd be sitting on a queue for about 7 days, 8 days to get in. And the queue is 32 miles long. I attracted just to see the queues are 32 miles long. And you remember, food, everything you want to buy today in Ukraine will come in through that road, and it's all sitting there, and they can't get in because the queue's that long. Again, just different places in Ukraine as we go around doing different villages. Again, you will see the children in Ukraine and that there, and you will see that no men are about because they are all down on active service. This is the last ones we got in here. You'll see them in the time the dam was bombed and it's flooded. This is the people trying to rush from their homes. There are some of the houses. You can see the roof, the water up, and they're screaming and they're trying to do their best. People with boats, people with everything trying to rescue. They have lost everything. They have lost their houses. They have lost everything. Ukraine has paid a big price, both in lives and in property and different things. Again, you just see as we visit the people in Ukraine that they're sitting there in their homes, some who can't move, and what can they do? These boys here are some of the boys that we pass the stuff on to, and they travel down in steady, as I say, 3 days a week. A mortar went off near them, and their van was blew up and scrapping on that, and you can see one of them's injured. The one's seriously injured, but he's still okay. But this boy was one of the old ones. How unspeakable wonderful it is to know that all our concerns are held in the hand that bled for us. These are the people waiting, and you can see they've received gifts, and as we give out the stuff, and as they move back into their little villages. Boys and girls, no matter where they are here in Ukraine, and we love them, we try our best to give them some help as they wait to make their life easy. I will instruct thee and teach thee, and in the ways thou shalt go, I will guide thee with my eye. Children again in Ukraine, some toys, just waiting for these little presents or whatever we give them to help them. Again, knocking at doors, prepare to meet thy God. At that slide the last time, I took that slide in Ukraine. As you go through the villages of Ukraine, two things I noticed. Every village now, which hadn't before, has flags up of their country, and even people in cars and tractors of Ukraine. And also, there is hundreds and hundreds of villages, and you see these flags. There, that's a red and a black, and the blue and yellow, you'll know that's the Ukraine flag, and then the other one. These are soldiers who have died fighting, and the red for the blood and the black for the death, and they're photo on them. Young men, I've looked at, stopped at so many, 19, 20, 22, 28, 30, all them ages of young lives in Ukraine. Coming here, the last one. So just these girls here are some of the ones that was where we stopped at a little town and gave them out some gifts and that sweets and things. Yes, today, forever, Jesus is the same. All may change, but Jesus never. Glory to his name. Thank you very much. We turn to Matthew 14 as a reading. I have a few thoughts from it there. And you'll know it's Jesus feeding the 5,000. And when I started this work in Romania, that was our aim. It just came to me that we should go around villages, and we tried it. They never hear tell of it. So we tried with villages and give out food, and it's great success that it's went for over 33 years. And just a bag of food, a knock on the door, and the people wanted to chat away and everything else. And it all came up, and then it was our opportunity to give a gospel track. I've met thousands and thousands of people this way, and many have come to know the Lord as their Savior. Jesus feeding the 5,000 was a further sign that Jesus is the Messiah, and is a gentle reminder to our daily Christian lives that nothing we face here on earth is ever too big for our God. He is all-knowing, he's all-powerful, all-loving, all-sovereign. And God knows all about us. That's one thing, God knows all about us. If you have time, I'm not going to take up time today. But look at Psalm 139, verses 1 to 6. The Lord who knows everything that you think, that you speak, and you do. Psalm 139, verses 1 to 6 is a good one to look. Have a look at. Here we see the disciples went and told Jesus in verse 13 about John the Baptist. If you look at that chapter, you have what Herod says about Christ, John the Baptist, when he's dead, and then the disciples came and told Jesus that John the Baptist had died. And there, when the people heard this, and when Jesus left, he went away to a place. He wanted to just go to a place by himself. And when the people heard this, they followed him on foot. He was moved when he seen the crowd. The Lord Jesus Christ was moved with compassion. He had a love for people that nobody else had. He just loved people, and he loved you and me. That's why he died on the cross of Calvary. He had a love for us. His compassion was to love people, to pity people, to sympathize with people who are suffering, to heal the sick, and to feed people. And it's still the same today. He fed them, as you see there before. He fed them before he preached. We do the same in a simple way. Just feed the people or give them a help. And you know, when they've seen the kindness, their hearts soften. People today are looking for kindness, love, and help. They're looking for compassion, and they don't know where to turn to find it. There is a void in everyone's heart, no matter whether it's Romania, Moldova, Ukraine, or anywhere else in the world in here. No, everyone has a void in their heart. And that's why Jesus came to die on the cross, to shed his precious blood, that you and I can have peace and know the peace of God in each of our hearts. He loves you, as the little hymn says, Jesus loves me, this I know. Why? Because the Bible tells me so. Then the disciples came to him and said, you know, this is a desert place we're in. And we had need to send them away. The disciples were like you and me today. You know, after a while, the crowd was there. Things were getting, they were seeing, getting hungry. That, you know, just what we would say, we need to go home. It's time to close this up. Hurry up, get this wrapped up. We have nothing to give them, you know. But in verse 16, Jesus says, they don't need to go away. Give them something to eat. And in verse 17 says, we have only 5 loaves and 2 fish, and there is over 5,000 besides men and women. The disciples were like us. This is no good here. What good is these here 5 loaves and 2 fish? What are you going to do with this? You know, that'd be like us. There's too big a crowd here. we're going to feed them. Oh, we haven't enough. What to do? Jesus said, bring them to me. Bring the loaves, bring the fish to me. They brought the small little gift, the small little food gift, 5 loaves and 2 fish. They brought it to Jesus and placed it in his hands. And you know this? It came all sufficient to meet the need. You know that he can meet your need, whatever that need is today. He will if you come to him. Nothing has changed in all these years. He's still the same today, and he is all sufficient to meet whatever your need will be. He is a God who loves. His grace and mercy is for you. Bring all to him. Bring everything. No, the smallest thing, doesn't matter what it is, bring it to Jesus. It is to be of any use. You will need to bring it to him. You see, the loaves and the fish would not have fed the multitude. No way would the loaves and the fish have fed if they had not brought to Jesus. They would have been of no value or of no use. Nothing. Without him, we can do nothing. The 5 loaves and the fish was little. But you know this? I have seen it. Little is much when God is in it. Whatever your need today, whatever your circumstances, he's waiting for your prayer to trust him for everything. Give him your life. Give him your heart. He took the loaves and the fish. And here we see, if you look here in verse 19, there's a few things he's done. He took. That's the first thing. He took. He will take your life and take care of it. Secondly of all, he looked. He looked and prayed to the Father in heaven. He gave thanks, and he's looking for you today. And he's wondering what. He blessed. He'll bless your life. He'll bless your home. He broke. He breaks the power of cancel sin in your life and sets you free. And lastly, he gave. Will give you joy. He'll give you peace. But most of all, he'll give you eternal life and a home in heaven. His love for the souls of men and women, boys and girls, everywhere. He just loves them. And he would come and put their trust in him as their Lord and Savior. So what did they do? Verse 20. So they all ate and were filled. They all ate and were filled. He's the only one that can fill the void that's in your heart. Also, there was enough. Enough for everything. And when Jesus comes, there's enough for everything. All you will need for earth, heaven, is found in the Lord Jesus Christ. There's more than enough for all. For there was 12 baskets even left over and more. He desires that all should come to him and know him as their own and personal Savior. That's why he came. That's why he died on the cross. That all men and women would find him as their own personal Savior. And when he sent the multitude away, you know what he done? He went away up into the mountain to pray for them. Psalm 46 verse 1 says, God is our refuge and strength, a very pleasant help in time of trouble. And you know this? You can bring all you want to Ukraine and their situation, but you know their hunger for the Lord. They know that people can't meet their every need. Everyone has their own problems. Everyone is busy trying to do their own thing. But you know this? The only one that has time for them and the only one they can find in their home or in their church is to accept the Lord and to pray to him that soon this trouble would pass. And our prayer is that you would pray that soon peace would come to that land where so many lives have been lost. In all thy ways, acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy path. He will give you eternal life, life worth living. And no matter what your troubles, no matter what happens to you, burdens are lifted at Calvary. People have burdens everywhere. Everywhere. People in here, you don't know each and all's troubles and burdens, but burdens are lifted at Calvary. Psalm 55, verse 22 says, cast your burdens on the Lord, and he shall sustain you. No one else. He shall sustain you. Will you trust him? The one who did so much for you, the one who gave his life for you in Calvary. God gave his son for you. He said, I am the way. I am the truth. I am the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. And you know this? There's only one way, and that's God's way. Will you make him and trust him as your Savior today? Amen.
Let us pray.
Lord, we thank you for these words of encouragement that Wolves has given us today. And again, can we encourage Wolves to keep going and his quest to try and make a difference to people's lives? But Wolves will appreciate, and Wolves says this all the time, that without God's help, he can't do it. He said, we can certainly provide for him. We can send stuff out with him. He can go and do the physical work out there. But without God's help, he's nothing. So thank you, Lord, for what you do today. And we thank you for the people who have just returned from the Smiles Foundation. And when you talk to them, they have a smile on their face. Aptly named organization, because they know that they've made a difference in the short period of time that they were away. So, Lord, these people, again, put themselves out, but they do it for your glory and your honor, as we ask this in your Son's name. Amen. Our final hymn today as we close is Facing a Task Unfinished.
Thank you.
Okay, Lord, thank you folks for joining with us today. And again, it's something slightly different. As an elders' service, we've done it before, and I'm sure we'll be asked to do it again. And again, thank you, Wills and Catherine, for your input into the service and those that played a part earlier on. We'll just finish with a benediction. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen.